Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. It is my pleasure to welcome you to this IOC briefing and to introduce you to Dr. Richard Budgett, who is the IOC Medical and Scientific Director. As you know, the IOC Executive Board convened this morning for its first day of meetings, and as anti-doping was on the agenda, we thought you'd be interested to hear from Dr. Budgett on the pre-games target testing program that the IOC has put in place ahead of the Olympic Winter Games, Pyeongchang 2018. Dr. Budgett will also talk about the reanalysis program that we've put in place for Beijing 2008, Vancouver 2010, and London 2012. And he will also give you a full update on the International Testing Agency. I just wanted to tell you, this will be a purely technical briefing that is not directly linked to the decision that will be made later on today. So we'd like to ask you to save your non-technical questions for the IOC president who will be with us tonight. So before I give the floor to Dr. Budgett, I would like to tell you that this morning the executive board approved a strategic approach on legacy for all future Olympic Games. This legacy strategy is part of the implementation of Olympic Agenda 2020 and was presented by Prince Albert of Monaco, who is also the chairman of the IOC Sustainability and Legacy Commission. The recommendations for that strategy were based on an extensive consultation with the Olympic movement, the 29 cities which have hosted past Olympic Games, and with external experts, academics, and NGOs. This legacy approach covers the various ways in which the IOC intends to further encourage, support, monitor, and promote legacy in partnership with its stakeholders. I'm not going to go into more details, as we're going to have Christophe Duby, our Olympic Games Executive Director, tomorrow here on this podium at lunchtime, and he can actually give you also a full update on Olympic Games preparations. So as promised, I'll give the floor to Dr. Budgett, who can clearly brief you on the pre-games testing program that the IOC has put in place ahead of Pyeongchang. Doctor, your floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon, everybody. I'm going to talk about three things which I think are very important to protecting the health of athletes and protecting the clean athlete. The first is the pre-games testing task force. The second is the reanalysis program, and the last is the International Testing Agency, the ITA. So first of all, the pre-games testing task force. As you know, this was in place for Rio, and again has been put in place before Pyeongchang. And we've learned lessons from Rio, so I think it's better and more effective than it was at those games. It's a partnership between the IOC and WADA, with five national anti-doping organizations, the Association of Olympic International Federations, and Winter Olympic International Federations, and the Secretariat is the Doping Free Sport Unit of GAFES. And it's a great example of all the stakeholders within anti-doping working together. The task force doesn't actually do tests itself, at least not unless there's an extreme situation. It is there to gather the best information from the IFs, from WADA, from all other intelligence it can get, looking at the performance of athletes, the grouping of athletes, and any special intelligence that comes to the task force, and advising the international federations and NADOs on who should be tested, giving recommendations of how often they should be tested, and in what way and what for. The task force reviewed all the testing that has been done since the 1st of April, which means really from the end of last season through to the current time, and then looking forward to the end of January, so just before the games start. Because, of course, the testing that's done in these 6 to 9 months is even more important, really, than the testing that's done at the games themselves. The games themselves are the most intensive period of testing that an athlete has during the course of a four-year period, but the time when we can really have a strong deterrent effect, where we can really help protect the clean athletes, is really in that lead up to the game. So hence this special stress. And as you've probably read, more than 7,000 tests have been done on these winter athletes, on over 4,000 of them from 62 countries so far, at least up until mid-November. And that is about 50% more than were performed in a similar period in 2016. The task force have looked at two groups of athletes, the athletes from individual sports and the athletes from so-called team sports. In this scenario, they're actually counting bobsleigh as a team sport, so bobsleigh, curling, and ice hockey, and giving different recommendations to those groups. So advice on nearly 3,000 tests on about 1,000 individual athletes and around 1,000 on the team sports. These are recommendations to the IFs and NADOs, but of course, as I'm sure you remember from the Olympic summit, in the case of Russian athletes, they are actually mandatory and required if they're going to be under any consideration for the Games. Now I'll move on to reanalysis. And this program has been ongoing since 2012, where the first reanalysis started from Athens. It's targeted. We have to remember we've got a limited resource there, so we use our intelligence as much as possible. In a similar way to the task force, talking to the international federations, to WADA, looking at athlete performance, looking at any past history of testing, the results of those testings, historical risk of groups of athletes, so that we can actually intelligently target the reanalysis of those samples. Of course, the bedrock of a reanalysis program is some advance, technical advance, either in sensitivity or a new test. And a great example of that, of course, was the long-term metabolites, which was why we were able to pick up so many cases of turinabol and stanazolol, those anabolic agents from London and Beijing. And I'm sure you will have read that in Beijing, the total in the end was 65 anti-doping rule violations, and so far 49 from London. The total number of reanalysis was over 1,000 for Beijing, and so far from London is nearly 600. For Vancouver, there were a large number of reanalysis, nearly 1,200. And this resulted, as I'm sure you know, in three adverse analytical findings, but those were all on one athlete, and that case is ongoing, so I can't actually talk about it in detail. Now, the last subject I'm going to talk about is the International Testing Agency. This will be established as a Swiss foundation and is on track to be established by Christmas. The IOC hope that this will be significantly operational by the time of Pyeongchang, in which case the ITA will take over key aspects of doping control, approving in principle and then on a daily basis the test distribution plan, which is who's going to be tested when and where, determining whether an adverse analytical finding should go forward to a potential anti-doping rule violation, and any therapeutic use exemptions that are granted at games time, and then referring any such cases to the Court of Arbitration of Sport, which is exactly what happened in Rio. If the ITA is not operational enough to do this, then it will use the Doping-Free Sport Unit, which is, after all, going to form the core of the ITA as it goes forward in the future. And then after Pyeongchang, the ITA will start to onboard international federations through 2018 and 2019. And we expect the ITA to provide that expertise, that independence and efficiency that will enable the international federations and other major event organizations to deliver a really effective doping control program, all for the sake of protecting the clean athletes. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Doctor. So let's now open the floor to questions. We'll start with Carlos. If you can maybe tell us, you know, who you are and where you're from. Thank you.
Can you hear me? Yeah. Carlos Grumman from Reuters. A question on the figures that you mentioned at the start. You've said 7,000 have been tested already, and how many is it going to be until the end? And what is the final percentage compared to Rio? Thank you very much.
I'll answer each one. Yes, now I was wondering whether we took a number of questions, then answer them all one by one. It's 7,000 tests so far, and that was in earlier in November, on 4,000 athletes. And that is on the website of the IOC. We don't know exactly how many, but there will be a lot more over the coming 2 or 3 months. Because we're into the winter season, so I strongly suspect the total number of tests will be over 20,000 by the time we get to the games themselves, and then you'll have to add on the games time testing on top of that. And I didn't quite understand the question about the final percentage compared to Rio.
If the final tally of tests would be around 20,000, how that would compare to the previous games, you know, especially to Rio, obviously.
I think we have to compare like with like, don't we? So we really have to look back to Sochi, and unfortunately we can't compare the figures running into Sochi because so many anti-doping organizations didn't use Adams efficiently and effectively. I'm very glad to say changing. The vast majority of anti-doping organizations are using Adams efficiently and effectively, and that's a very strong, and that's something we really strongly encourage because it's a great help in the fight against doping. Everybody knows who's tested when and where.
Thank you. And just for you to know, we have a fact sheet that will be distributed later by Rachel. You have all the figures and all the details that the doctor just gave you. Next question. Yes, over there. Lady over there. Thank you.
Rachel Axon from USA Today. You mentioned the comparison to Rio and improving things, but the Independent Observer report found more than 1,900 high-risk athletes and more than 4,000 total who hadn't been tested in the lead-up. So what's been changed to properly address those holes so that those athletes will be among the pool of those tested before Korea?
That is exactly sums it up, is why we need a pre-games task force, because we need to motivate and measure the work of the international federations and the NADOs to make sure that testing really is efficient and effective. Now, I think we don't go as far as saying every single athlete has to be tested, but every single athlete needs to be part of an effective anti-doping program. And I think most people would consider someone who ended up the games should have been tested at some point. It was clear in Rio, particularly in some of the big team sports, that not everyone is tested. So obviously it requires an awful lot of resources, but it has to be prioritized. And I think part of the work of the pre-games task force is to make sure that this is prioritized.
Okay, next question for Eric over there.
Bonjour, Monsieur Budgett.
Question in French, if I may.
Have you emphasized the testing on Russian athletes among the 7,000 tests you made in the last month?
Yes, I can tell you that, you will see in the figures, and the figures are on the website, that the Russian athletes have been tested more than any other country by a considerable margin. The requirements for Russian athletes are being particularly emphasized by the pre-games testing task force because of the situation and the work of the commissions, so that the requirements are in detail, as they are for every other group of athletes, for the top individual top 20, but also for the team sports, and also for those Russian athletes on the so-called long list who make it to the games, may qualify for the games in the end, but aren't actually in the top 20 or so that are due for a medal. And so requirements have been issued to the international federations, to RUSADA, for the level of testing of those athletes, which requirement has not been issued to the other the other countries' athletes.
Thank you. Next question for Hayo, front row. Merci.
Thank you, Richard. Just allow me to address another issue. It's with respect to another story about the Jamaican athletes in spring 2017. As you know, that there have been Jamaican male sprinters and their urine in a retest from the 2008 samples, Glenn Butterill was found. And IOC decided in collaboration with WADA not to proceed these cases. That means there was a screening with Glenn Butterill and it was not confirmed and it was not published. And the same kind of scheme or kind of procedure happened with Russia, because Russia, in their doping cover-up scheme, they did exactly more or less the same. That means they had a screening, a positive screening, and they didn't confirm the positive samples. So can you give us an explanation why IOC was dealing with the Jamaican cases in such a way which is very similar to the Russian way of doing it?
I cannot say whether or not there were any Jamaican cases, but in the case of there were clenbuterol positives from the reanalysis from Beijing, we went to the World Anti-Doping Agency and said, what should we do about these? If they are in that very low level, which is consistent with contamination from food. Now, the normal case management would involve notifying the athlete of an adverse analytical finding and then actually investigating that finding, so finding out where they've eaten, looking at the sources, possible sources of food. Of course, that is really very difficult to do 8 years later. So WADA advised us that it was unreasonable to expect an athlete to do that, and so there was no need to take the case forward and actually confirm the adverse analytical finding, because this was on a provisional finding, and the way the reanalysis was done for Beijing, we had to split the B sample, and it was the B1 that was the actual true A sample. And so it was deemed unreasonable to go forward, considering the well-known contamination of meat products in China and one or two other countries in the world, because this would put the athletes in an impossible position.
Thank you, Doctor. Next question from Nick over there. Thanks.
Thank you. Nick Butler from Inside the Games. And what's happening with the reanalysis program from Chur in 2006, which hasn't been completed, in the case against the Estonian cross-country skier Kristina Šmigun-Vähi? And secondly, you mentioned that CAS will make the final ruling on cases in Pyeongchang, but have you decided if CAS will do that permanently once the ITA gets going fully in 2018 and 2019? Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, Nick. The first one I cannot, unfortunately, comment, because obviously it's under legal proceedings, so I can't confirm or say anything about that reanalysis from Torino. As regards the use of the Court of Arbitration of Sport anti-doping division, that was done in Rio. It's been done again in Pyeongchang. It will be up to the ITA in future to decide whether to carry on with that or to actually prosecute the cases themselves. So that will be the ITA who decides what happens in Tokyo and beyond.
Okay, I think we have a question from Callum over there, and then we'll move to you, Mwakako. Thanks.
Hello, Richard. Callum Murray from SportCal. Just another question about the ITA. I know that not all IFs are obliged to sign up to the ITA. Is there any indication yet what proportion of them are willing to do so?
Well, we're in a fantastic position, thanks to GAFES and the Doping Free Sport Unit, that there are around 40 international federations, that's Olympic and recognized and non-recognized, that are already part of this organization. So they will be the first group who would join the ITA. But there are a number of other Olympic international federations who've expressed strong interest. And of course, until the ITA have a director general, they have they're operationally in place, it's difficult to totally commit an international federation to joining the ITA. But there is strong interest from a large number of international federations, and I would expect the ITA to grow really quite fast through 2018 and 2019.
Wakako, thanks.
Thank you, Rachel, and thank you. Wakako Yuki from Yomiuri Shimbun. Two questions, Doctor. One is, it's good to hear so many numbers of retesting being positive, yielding some result, but at the same time, to basically restore the credibility of competition and sport, especially for the spectators and athletes, you do need to catch them previous or on-site with what you are doing with especially chemical substance part of traditional anti-doping. And what is the belief that you have, how robust these could be prepared for Pyeongchang? And just very quick, actually, follow up to Eric's. You did say, yes, Russian athletes are one of the main targets. Have there any reported difficulties, as in the past, for instance, to how smoothly you could test those athletes to enter a certain cities, or, for instance, conduct anti-doping tests unaware? Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm not sure I fully understood your first question, but it was about the credibility of the reanalysis. And of course, it is very important for credibility, but it's also really important for deterrence as well. And I think the system for Pyeongchang is more robust than ever, thanks to this pre-games testing task force. So the athletes who go there can be more confident than ever. Of course, all the testing in the world is never 100% guarantee that anyone is not taking a prohibited substance or method, but it does really help. And we know from evidence that's been published that once you get to around half a dozen tests, if they're unpredictable, then that has an excellent deterrent effect and near maximum deterrent effect, but even one or two can have a very strong deterrent effect. And the reported difficulties, well, you would have heard the reports from the WADA Foundation Board meeting, and that was one of the reasons that RUSADA was not reinstated as compliant with WADA, and it was because there was a case of a difficulty entering one of the closed cities. But as I understand it, and I only have the same understanding as the rest of you, in the vast majority of cases, that new system is working well, and the doping control officers are getting access to the athletes in the city without notice. But clearly that's something WADA are monitoring extremely closely, and it's very important to the future accreditation of RUSADA.
Okay, thank you. I think we've got time for one more question, as we'll have to let the doctor go. He's supposed to follow the proceedings this afternoon. We have one last question over there on the right. Thank you.
Thank you. Hello, Hugo Curti from 24 Heures in Lausanne. You said the agency will have Swiss foundations. Do you know exactly in which city it will be based?
It will be based around Lausanne. So I can't say it's actually going to be in the city of Lausanne, but it will be in the environment, because it's very important that although it's separate and independent from its stakeholders, which will, the majority of which will be international federations, it is near to those international federations to maximize the effectiveness of the programs it puts in place, because those IFs can't actually wash their hands of any responsibility for doping control. They are still responsible under the code for delivering an anti-doping program in their sport. It's just they're delegating that work to this international agency. And it's important that the intelligence, that the details, that they know how their sport runs, they know where the potential problems are, those are communicated effectively to this ITA.
Thank you, Anna. Just a quick second question. You said that three of the reanalyses in Vancouver were positive for the same athlete. Is it going? There is a case for suspension yet, or it's too soon to say?
That case is ongoing. As soon as it's completed, then it will be published on the IOC website, as are the other reanalysis cases.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, if we're done with questions, before we go, I'd like to give you some details about the process of the Executive Board meeting this afternoon with regard to the findings of the Schmidt Disciplinary Commission. The IOC President was given the Schmidt report today. Then the Executive Board this afternoon will hear from both Denis Oswald, who will give an update on the work of his disciplinary commission, and then from Samuel Schmidt, the former president of the Swiss Confederation, who chaired the disciplinary commission into the question of systematic manipulation of anti-doping system in Russia. Then the executive board members will get the Schmidt report. There will be an open discussion, and the executive board will reach its decision. For you to know, a Russian delegation is present in Puyi at the IOC headquarters. They will be given the right to see the report and also to present a statement to the executive board members. The Russian delegation will be the first one to be informed about the EB decision later on today. The materials that you will get, you the media tonight, will be exactly the same as those on which the executive board members have actually based their decision. So you will get actually the IOC executive board decision and the full Schmidt report. So the press conference to announce the decision will be tonight with the IOC president, Thomas Bach, and with Samuel Schmidt at 7:30. And again, as you can imagine, we had a lot of requests for individual interviews, and unfortunately we're not able to accommodate all of them. However, the IOC president will be doing a pool interview with Reuters after the press conference, and this will be shared with you shortly after this. So this is it from us. Thank you very much, Dr. Budgett. We free you. We can go back to the EB. Thanks all of you for joining us, and we'll see you tonight with the president. Thank you.